Good evening, everyone. My name's Christine Alexander, and I'm an Emeritus Professor of English at UNSW. I'm involved in a very exciting project with academic colleagues here and overseas. And this is why I have the privilege of welcoming you. I'm a director and general editor of the Juvenilia Press, an international organisation of academic editors hosted by the School of the Arts and Media and the Faculty of Arts and Social Sciences. So, on behalf of the Juvenilia Press and the School of the Arts and Media, I would like to welcome you. And we're very, very pleased that you've all come, of course, to help us celebrate not only a book launch, but also this premiere performance of The Double Disguise. First, I'd like to thank our sponsors of the play, Ronan MacDonald and the Irish Studies Association, thank you, and the School of the Arts and Media, particularly the Creative Practice Unit, Sue Goldfish, Paul Matthews, and Mark Mitchell. They've done a tremendous amount of work on this performance, and we're very grateful indeed. Our thanks also to Martin Fox, who is making a video of the performance for us, so you can always see it on the website later if you want to. And we're very grateful too to the UNSW Bookshop for coming this evening and for the opportunity, creating the opportunity for everybody afterwards to buy a copy of The Double Disguise by Maria Edgeworth if you don't already have one and would like one. We'll also have other books on display, as you'll see out there. Now, tonight's performance is student-led, and I think this is really exciting. This means that our very special thanks go to Shannon Ely, the director of our play, to Anna Grieg, our co-director, and to the wonderful cast of students whom they've assembled. They're all going to be bringing Maria Edgeworth's youthful drama alive for the very first time. This is, in fact, a world premiere. You are a very privileged audience. And Shannon and her co-director have actually worked incredibly hard on what I think is actually a very challenging play to perform. It's a period piece. She's been really diligent in researching all the historical content and also Edgeworth's own experience of drama, her early experience of drama, particularly with the family plays that they put on always at Christmas time with family and friends. And this is just one of those plays. Shannon's kept Donna and myself very busy. Donna is our very valued Juvenilia Press assistant. She's kept us both very busy with lists of queries about the text itself, about the setting, and about 18th century life. And I've been really impressed by the thoroughness with which tonight's performance has been researched and thought of, really thought out, by all the students who are involved. So I really want to thank all of them, if they can hear me at all. I'd also like now to turn to the edition itself, to the actual physical publication of this previously unpublished manuscript. The Dean of our faculty has kindly agreed to launch this book for us, and he'll be doing this later in a few minutes. But I'd like to thank him in advance. I'd like to thank our talented illustrator, who can't be with us tonight, but who has had one of her illustrations actually chosen by the designer for the front cover. So I hope she's pleased. I'd like to thank our designer, Winston Pei, a former student editor who actually worked on one of our volumes and who now has his own design business. And especially, I think, as I said, we must thank, well, I didn't say we'd thank her, but we must. Donna Kuto, where is she? There, over there. Thank you, Donna, for everything you do for the Juvenilia Press. We couldn't exist without her. Now, I also want to say that Donna has contributed markedly to this particular edition. She has written the appendix and has meticulously double-checked our transcriptions of the text. The accuracy of the volume has been much enhanced by her expertise, and I'm delighted to announce, she doesn't know I'm going to do this, but she has plans to join us in the school as a PhD student next year. So that's very exciting. Now, you will have gathered that I'm actually wearing two hats this evening. First, I'm representing the Juvenilia Press, and I'll say a very few words about that in a few minutes. But I'm also, secondly, co-editor and mentor editor for this volume. So first I'd like to pay tribute to my co-editor, Ryan Twomey. Dr. Ryan Twomey, where is he? Ryan, can you take a bow, please? I think we should congratulate him. Ryan teaches now at Macquarie University, and last year we had an earlier book launch at Macquarie Co-op Bookshop, where his colleagues celebrated this edition. I want to thank him for this and also for the many years of contact we've had as him as a student and me as a mentor and now as academic colleagues. Ryan is now an expert on the writing of Maria Edgeworth. He's particularly familiar with her early text, and I don't think it's too much to say that The Double Disguise helped launch his career. The project was conceived a number of years ago when Ryan was first working on his PhD thesis at UNSW under my supervision. He made the original transcription of the play in the Bodleian Library in Oxford, although we've both since retranscribed a lot of it and modified the text for this edition. It's a very, very difficult text to work on. I was on leave at Cambridge at the time, and we were both able to discuss the manuscript and its problems immediately and after seeing it. In fact, it seems to be an ongoing discussion. The Double Disguise, as I said, is particularly difficult to work on, and you'll gather this if you happen to read the notes here on the editing of it. Ryan's PhD was on the importance of juvenilia in the development of an author. Maria Edgeworth was part of this thesis, one of the chapters, and it has now been published. A year ago, Ryan was able to attend an international juvenilia conference at Durham University in England, where he gave a paper on his juvenilia work. And he'll be speaking on this again at the next conference that's going to be held in Barcelona in June. More recently, his work on Edgeworth's juvenilia has led to his editing of the Norton Critical Edition of Edgeworth's most famous novel, Castle Rackrent, and this is a considerable achievement. He's also currently editing another Juvenilia Press volume with one of his students, and so the expertise is passed down. He is now going to be the mentor editor. And this is what leads me, in fact, to talking about the Juvenilia Press, because this is a really good example of what we're about. The idea is that we pass down our skills from mentor editor to student, and from student who then becomes a mentor editor, if possible. So very briefly, the Juvenilia Press is a very untypical publisher. We are non-profit, and we are really a project, a learning and teaching and research project. It's part of an educational and creative process, and student involvement is absolutely essential in our project. We exist to promote teaching, research, and learning, and we have rather a large network now, an international group of participating academics in Canada, in the USA, in the UK, Spain, Japan, Australia and New Zealand. I've mentioned our conferences just now. If any of you are interested in finding out more about the Juvenilia Press or attending any of our conferences, please feel free to go to the website and also go and like us on Facebook, which I understand is the right term. You're supposed to like us. Sorry about that. We need lots of people to like us. Our main aim is to promote the study of literary juvenilia, youthful writing by authors up to the age of about 20. The research and teaching are linked to, in fact, my own interest in the idea of juvenilia, literary juvenilia, as a significant area of historical, literary, social, and creative research. And as you will have gathered, the learning involves qualified academic editors working with students in the field of critical editing and the production of books, which is seldom taught nowadays in the academy. It involves the transcribing of a manuscript, developing an editorial policy, researching the content, writing textual and contextual notes, appendices, introductions, and the like. Volumes differ, of course, according to the amount of student input, but in the case of this particular volume, Ryan and I have been working together as colleagues for some time on this particular work. The publishing is always, we need the publishing because it's the necessary end product of this creative and scholarly process. Now, I'd be remiss if I didn't say very quickly that any contribution you can make by buying our books would be greatly appreciated, since we need to cover costs for each production. We're non-profit, as I said, and we survive chiefly on grants where we can obtain them and on covering our costs by sales. We also have a new initiative, which you'll see on the back of your program and which the Dean will kindly launch for us. The publication of our particular volume today has been supported by the Department of English at Macquarie University and by the School of the Arts and Media at UNSW, and we're really grateful for their assistance. And finally, I'd like to stress the significance of this particular volume. You'll see from our flyer and the website, and from the website, that our publications are chiefly volumes produced by talented young writers from the early 19th century on to the modern period. People like Charlotte Bronte, Lewis Carroll, George Eliot, Charles Dickens, Philip Larkin, Margaret Atwood, and the like. And also youthful Australian literary productions, Dorothy Hewitt, Ethel Turner, and others. Jane Austen, whom we've done a lot of volumes of, as a late 18th century writer is an exception. But we have very few 18th century or earlier Juvenilia volumes. So it's really good to have this one by Maria Edgeworth, who wrote just before Jane Austen and whom Jane Austen much admired. And Edgeworth, an important 18th century Anglo-Irish writer, influenced one of the great writers of the 19th century too, Sir Walter Scott. I just want to read very briefly from the first paragraph in here, in the introduction. After meeting fellow author Maria Edgeworth in 1823, Sir Walter Scott wrote that Edgeworth exceeded the expectations he had formed of this very remarkable person. "I'm particularly pleased," he said, "with the naivety and good-humoured ardour of her mind, which she unites with such formidable powers of acute observation. I will never believe that she doesn't have a wand in her pocket and pulls it out to conjure a little before she begins to write those very striking pictures of manners." Those are the pictures we're going to be seeing tonight, pictures of manners, and particularly some Irish pictures of manners. Scott, of course, was speaking of Maria Edgeworth's very famous novel, Castle Rackrent. Little did he know that she had already been writing about Irish characters and these special pictures of manners at the age of 18 in The Double Disguise. So this publication is particularly significant because it's the very first time this manuscript has ever been published, plus it's the very first time that it has ever been performed. Now, I would very much like to introduce Professor James Donald, the Dean of the Faculty of Arts and Social Sciences, who's very kindly going to perform a triple act.
A triple act, but not a triple somersault, I assure you. I have 5 minutes in which to do this triple act, so I'll move briskly through it. So the first thing I have to launch is the book, which I don't need to say more about because Christine has already said something about that, and I have no pretensions to being a Maria Edgeworth scholar, and I have to admit that Castle Rackrent has been on my list of novels to be read when I have more time in the future list for several decades. But I'm very happy to do the formal launching of this book. In doing so, I want to take a couple of minutes to say what a great achievement the Juvenilia Press is. Very soon after I became dean, Christine Alexander appeared in my office asking for money, which he has continued to do periodically for the past 8.5 years. They've always been very pleasant discussions, and I'm sorry, Christine, I've never been able to give you as much money as you would have liked, but I'm delighted that we've managed somehow to give you enough that the thing is still going. And I have to say, it is incredibly impressive that this project, which I think, you know, Christine summarizes so beautifully as both a teaching process, a teaching tradition, which also produces the books as a very splendid byproduct. I was looking through the website this afternoon and just seeing the desk outside, the back catalogue is now really quite extraordinary. It's a very substantial archive of work, and it's very novel, it's very imaginative, and it's extraordinarily well done. And that doesn't happen without vision, without passion, and without a will of steel. And I just have to say, on a personal note, that I think it's wonderful to see Christine tonight speaking with her characteristic professionalism, her dazzling scholarship, and indeed such grace at a very difficult time. So well done, Christine. The second thing I have to launch is a great new scheme called Sponsor an Edition, which is it's another of Christine's fundraising activities, but it's a really magical one. This invites people to contribute to money so that they can get recognition of some sort, they get free copies, and if you put in enough money, you can actually select an author whose Juvenilia can be sort of researched and developed in this way on your account. There are a number of editions in the planning if people are interested. Amongst them are up for grabs are Catherine Mansfield, Edith Wharton, Agatha Christie, Harold Pinter, and the poet whom James Joyce referred to as Alfred Lord Tennyson, and several others equally as compelling. So it's on the website, and I really do encourage you to go and have a look. And it's, you know, and if, you know, it would also be a great gift to give to somebody to actually say, here is, you know, rather than a bench in the park, you know, an addition in your name would be a great thing to do. So that's my second launch done. The third thing I have to launch is the play. I've no idea how you launch a play. I don't need to say anything about it, because if I say anything, you'll find out in 5 minutes that I'm all wrong. So I think all one can say is, look, there's a great scheme in the Sponsor an Edition. Juvenilia Press is a great project. And in terms of, I think, the way one launches a play is to say, on with the show.
Accomplished Greville's hasty prayer, I hurl my spells into the spongy air.
Oberon, my name, of magic skills to raise the drooping spirits by the power of praise. Indifference, with this fairy wand, I charm. And with each youthful, friendly bosom warm. So shall the mimic visions of the night delude your judgments and enchant your sight. And lords and ladies who for Christmas gamble to see your friends across the inny ramble through three long acts must sit the tedious while, dull though it be, shall never cease to smile. Nor dare to hiss! But clap each little actor. content the course with homemade manufacture.
Why, Jabus, Mrs. Landlady, I make the deciding vote for another and more suitable apartment.
We must
not let Dolly catch cold.
Oh, for that matter, sir, lackaday, if I'd known Miss was puny or so, I'd have tried harder to give her a different room. I should hate to have any lady say she caught cold in my house. Betty!
Here, Mum.
Do step, child, and prepare the great assembly room. Ah, ladies, I'm as glad as twopence that I thought of the great assembly room. Though I've never opened it before for any company except on assembly day, for the subscribers take it by the quarter.
Well, Mrs. Landlady, you need not stand upon that, for if you knew all, you never had gentler company in it.
Oh, I don't doubt that now.
Please to walk this way, ladies.
Your aft gentry always give one more trouble than the best quality in the land. I will say that for them.
Come, me good girl. Make us up a good fire. Bring me the newspaper as soon as convenient.
Oh, pray do bring the newspaper directly, for I long to know the fate of my ticket in the lottery.
By Jabez, Dolly, I think your head revolves around that same ticket.
Dear sir, I am so impatient.
Oh, and so am I for my supper. So, Mercy, pray get the landlady. And here. Take this, me good girl. Make sure the hilt of it is good and plain. The sword of a volunteer can never be contaminated.
Sir! Oh, your servant. Ladies, I hope you don't find it too cold in here. Oh, Bessie, the careless girl has let the fire get low.
May you have in the house?
Oh, well, ma'am, we've fine veal cutlets and a joint of mutton and, fine beef, ma'am, tender as a chicken and game and fish and poultry, fine pigeons ready to spit and excellent Shrewsbury brown. Would you have the veal cutlets, ma'am? We're famous for veal cutlets at the Pig and Castle.
What, and have ye no confectionery?
Confectionaries, Dolly. She means, Mrs. Landlady. Pies or tarts or any other sweet things.
Oh, yes, have you any gooseberry tarts?
Gooseberry tarts in the depths of winter? Ma'am, terribly sorry, your ladyship. We've some fine calf's foot jelly.
Oh, yes, well, let's have two or three glasses of calf's foot jelly. Opposite to the cutlets on the other side.
Wouldn't your ladyship choose the beef?
Oh, yes, whatever you please, ma'am.
Boy, Jabez, darling, you'd have done better to begin with your last word, Mrs. Landlady. As old as my daughter may look, she's just come out of the boarding school, and you know it's not there that young ladies learn how to order supper.
Oh, lackaday, sir, I'm sure Miss has time enough and plenty. She'll have supper at 10 then, sir?
Oh, yes, as it please you.
Oh, very good, sir.
Lord, what a figure it makes one to be jolted about in a stagecoach for so many hours together. Thank God there was nobody but ourselves at our last stage, but then there was the stage before last where the great fat cheesemonger's wife and I stifled me to death and sat right down next to me without saying with your leave or by your leave. Oh, and Fanny, there was that mother and child you took such a fancy to. And must needs sit upon your lap half the stage. I protest I could see no beauty in it for my part. When the mother offered us almonds and raisins, I thought she'd turn out to be some grocer's wife or other.
Take care, Dolly. You're on tender ground between you and I. Remember what you are to some of yourself.
Oh, dear sir, if you and my mother did own a grocer's shop, it was in the wholesale line. Besides, you know that was before I was born. But you are a volunteer now, sir, you know, and a gentleman, you know, and so do, Papa. Let's take a chaise and four next stage. What signifies the expense of the next two stages we have to go? It would be but a guinea extraordinary, hostlers, chayboy, turnpikes and all. Oh, Papa.
By Jabez, Dolly, you'd wheedle the bird off the bush. So you shall and have your own way then, and you'll live the longer for it.
Oh, thank you, Papa. For really, what would Captain Campbell have thought to see us arrive into town in such a vehicle?
Oh, pardon me, ladies. Is one of you Miss Dolly Coco?
I am Miss Dorothy Coco.
Oh, well, ma'am, I've a letter here down that a gentleman gave from the Dilly, and a letter here that Captain Campbell, sir, servant for?
Captain Campbell.
Aye, miss. His servant came ahead to bespeak his bed and supper. The captain will be along shortly. Would you care to step into your drawing room, ladies? We've a fine, airy, two-bedded chamber.
There'll be time enough for that, Mrs. Landlady. But you forgot to get me my newspaper.
Oh, lackaday, sir, 1,000 pardons. I shall step in and send someone for it immediately. Betty! Betty!
Well, I think that grating landlady would have stayed all night. I didn't choose to open my B.A. do before her. Oh, la. A letter from Charles Westbrook. Your sincere admirer, T. Campbell, cannot express violent impatience to see my dear Miss Coco. Could not prevail upon myself to wait till you arrived in town. Never had an easy moment since. Accidentally saw you there. La, la, la. Good friend Mrs. Deputy Dwindle has written at my desire proposals in. I do not doubt my being able to give Mr. Coco every possible assurance as to the settlement he may expect. Mere mercenary matters those, but I'm impatient to give dear Miss Coco in person my every possible assurance of my being with the greatest respect. Sincere admirer, T. Campbell. Oh, he must be a man of fashion, he writes so elegant. I admire it of all things.
Dear, I'm so glad to hear from poor Charles. I know a time, cousin, when you would not have left one of his letters, sir.
I was a child then. When he went abroad, I knew nothing of the world then.
Read his letter, however, cousin. Consider he has been gone these 3 years, and if it is only to hear that he is alive, it is something.
Fanny, dear, why don't you read it aloud then, seeing as you are so set upon it?
Safe arrived at last, my dear Dolly.
Dolly, indeed.
Imagine the joy I feel at the thought of seeing you again after 3 years' absence. If you feel but half as much, every wish of my heart would be satisfied. Our regiment landed a few days ago. I have sold my commission, for I hope that we shall never part again. The past has cost me too much, my dear Dolly.
Dolly again? How vulgar.
But it was for your sake. I bring you back a small, but what I hope you will think a competent fortune, which has been hardly earned. Remember me to my dear father, as I hope I may call him, and to all my old friends, not forgetting.
What stops you, child?
Not forgetting cousin Fanny. And accept every kind wish from your truly affectionate Charles Westbrook.
Well, really, cousin, it is the kindest letter. How happy you must be to hear from him.
How you speak, child. I am no such novice to be taken in with a few compliments.
It's all over with poor Charles, I say. She's all hoity-toity with her London captain. But I beg your pardon, Dolly. His letter went nigher my heart than your captain's billet. Except for that part about the settlement, hey, Dolly? Come, let's see Captain Campbell's again.
Captain Campbell, sir?
Yes. Why, Jabez, there's a little bit of postscript on the other side that we missed. I am under the disagreeable necessity of preparing me, dear Miss Coco, for some slight unfortunate circumstances, which I fear might prepossess her against my appearance at first sight. My too rash ambition to signalise myself in the last war not only endangered my life, but exposed me my limbs to accidents. Misfortunes, which irremediable as they are, I never so severely felt than at this instant. Those limbs come lagging in sadly.
To be sure, it is a sad pity.
limbs too, Dolly. In the plural number.
But really, for my sake, I think we ought to... I think we ought to like a man the better for having lost his limbs in the service of his country.
Well, I hope that's the real reason for your compassion, Dolly. Oh.
Well, Fanny, I must look an absolute fright. I must smarten myself up a little before the captain's arrival, mustn't I? Yes, you know, I simply can't do my hair behind without you.
My dear, if you want me, I will come with you with all my heart.
Why, there's Dolly's head turned topsy-turvy. We'll have no sense out of her tonight.
Wife is well known. Her apparel betokens her a monastery. Her ribbons of linos and lace become the fair face of the landlady.
Hey, how's that, fella? Sing that again.
The endeavoring man's wife is well known. Her apparel betokens her a monastery. Her ribbons of linos and lace become the fair face of the landlady. La ma'am, it is a strange thing, if I may be so bold as to say so, Mrs. Thunder. I feel as...
Mrs. Thunder? Why, how does the fellow know my name?
Oh, I'm sure it was written plain enough under her sign. Now, if you but lend me your fair plump hand, Mrs. Landlady, I can tell you of stranger things. No? Things of past and to come, things that you do know, and things that you don't know.
Oh, no, no, don't tell me.
But I was saying, your ladyship, you are the very image, begging your pardon, of a woman in Flanders. An officer's wife. Who robbed me of my heart and kept me at death's door for nearly a 12th month! The same colored eyes, no? The same colored hair down to a shade. But ma'am, you're as like as two peas. Yes, the same round, good, humid, sweet, bewitching face. God is my witness. I swear you are as like 2 drops of water.
Oh.
You are very, you've had 2 husbands, Mrs. Thunder.
Why, love, fellow, how should you know that?
The 2 gold rings on her wedding finger told the truth then. Ah! And if you would give me your hand again, if you would trust me with it, I can tell you everything exactly. No?
So a man about 6 foot high, wearing a dark, lovely brown velvet chest thing. His hair slicked back with a new black ribbon, a gold watch in his pocket, and a golden cane. Just give me a okay. I shall come and stand before this bar.
Oh, well, I am always at the bar, or nigh hand. But how shall I know the day, sir? For I would keep in the way, as it were, to give the stars fair play.
No. You cannot help but be in the way today.
No?
These stars will bring you here true to a minute. So you'll take a pound of molding cantus in your hand, and when you look up, you shall see your gentleman standing right before you.
Oh, Lord, sir. And what shall I say then?
Shh, nothing.
But surely, Mr. Conjurer, I should ask him what he would desire to have for supper, or if he would care
Mrs.
to sit
Lando,
down.
Mrs. Landlady, are you in the bar?
Coming presently! Well, Mr. Conjurer, just you step here into the bar for a minute, and I shall come for you presently.
Mrs. Landlady, Mrs. Thunder, are you within?
Can't you have a moment's patience? Well, girl?
Why, Mom, Nan Cook's running wild for the jelly bag, and Jim Waiter wants a cask of wine, and I have no pillowcases for the comet, Mom.
Well, and could you not have seen to that before? Oh, I believe your head's a sieve, girl. Right. Tell Jim that he shall come for the wine between this and supper time, and come again for the pillowcases anon.
Oh, do you hear? And the jelly bag, Mom.
Mercy on us, my stars, God forgive me, but if it's not one of you after my feet every minute of the day, you're all as helpless as babes in the woods.
Boots! Boots, do come and uncoil the big air trunk that came with the stage. Miss says she must have it in the peacock. And Boots, have you seen the Mrs. Blue bandbox? It's wrapped up in a red handkerchief. And can't you speak a little louder?
I said I don't know nothing about it, I don't. It's not my business to see to the inside luggage. I suppose it be within the bar. The coachman knows, always put it within there. Why, you should have seen him the other day with all the luggage. Huge amounts of it.
Boots never will lend one an helping hand. In the bar, is it? Oh, whoa!
Not be frightened, no. Okay, I'm a conjurer. The bag, what the blue bag box? Here, it's yours. Yeah. Now I was telling the fortune of your mistress, and mayhap you do me the same good turn, mayhap I do the same good deed by you, no?
Oh, do pray, good Mr. Conjurer, lackadaisy. I beg your pardon, but my aunt misgave me, I was in such a fright. Do pray, Mr. Conjurer, bring me my fortune. I long to hear of it, of all things.
Have you heard of the inn at Salt Hill, Mrs. Betty?
Mrs. Partridge.
Yeah, Mrs. Partridge, yeah. Lend me your hand, come on. Let's go. Okay. Whew. Oh, so, I see you in this time, in 2 years, Mrs. Betty, Mrs. Landlady, I should say, giving orders to your own servants in the same bar of the great house of Mrs. Parridge's great inn at Salt Hill.
Me, dear, me, Mr. Conjurer.
Yes, you, Mrs. Betty. Now, do you know your sign that is to be?
Mrs. Partridge used to have the windmill.
Yeah, the windmill, yeah. Oh, well, yeah, I can see it beginning to spin around with the winds of your good fortune.
Mrs. Betty, for heaven's sake, woman, do not keep us waiting all night.
Oh, if that ain't the Mrs. Screaming. Your servant, thank you, sir.
Box.
So I have got the coast clear at last. How I shall get through with this, I know not. I did but hear the sound of her voice, and I had the light to betray myself. What shall I do then when I actually see her? She can't know me, to be sure. There's no danger in that. I'm completely disguised.
Betty! Betty, don't! Jelly bag! Come, pillowcase!
A pretty part I've undertaken. 3 carriages in 1 night. The last, I hope, will be like the best. But I have not yet done with my first. I must contrive to see Dolly, to sound her heart to the bottom as the fortune teller, and then return in my second character as Captain Campbell, to try what vanity and interest can do, and at last, when my triumph in hers is complete, I shall reveal myself to be her old favorite, Charles Westbrook, return to enjoy the reward of his constancy. But who goes here? Her sweet cousin Fanny.
The fire has gone out in the peacock, and I must beg Mrs. Landlady to let me heat the curling irons for my cousin in the bar fire.
Well, good lady, if I could be of any good service to you, I hope. I shall certainly betray myself.
No, I thank you, sir. I'm not used to be waited upon. I can do it very well for myself. I am obliged to you. I do not like to give people trouble. But to be sure, it is rather a hard matter to find one's way over such a strange house.
Do pray, miss. If you give me leave, I can call anyone you may please to want. Oh, Mrs. Betty! Mrs. Betty! Here's a lady who cannot find her way.
Do pray, miss, leave the lions with me.
Oh, Mrs. Betty, if you would be so good. But you won't keep my cousin waiting, for she is in a great hurry.
Oh, Mrs. Betty, I'm so glad to get a sight of you again.
Mr. Conjurer, I can't stop gossiping with you now.
One word, Mrs. Betty. Do get me sight to the ladies in the peacock. You'll
see, Mrs. Betty, they will give me something handsome, I'm sure.
Well, I'll try what I can do for you then, Mr. Conjurer. When the missus dressed, the Lord knows when that'll be.
Well, Mrs. Betty, could not I get in the meantime as a hairdresser? Not to tell the ladies I'm a rare hand at the goon!
Dear heart, how you wheedle one. Come on and follow me and we'll see what we can do.
I must say you're very awkward. My head's as crooked as a ram's horn. The captain ain't come yet, I hope?
Oh, la, no, miss. There's no sign of him. I dare say he won't be here these 3 hours.
Oh, then I may breathe. You needn't wait, child.
Begging your ladyship's pardon, as you won't be hurried or so, there's one waiting there without to get a sight of you. The man dresses hair purely, if your ladyship would care to try him. Oh, yes, cousin, do let's see him, if it's only to give him something. I met him just now, and he really is the civilest poor man you ever saw.
Very well, then, call the fellow in, and let's see what he can do.
Ladies, I am most profoundly yours.
Well, sir, you can dress hair, I think they tell me.
Me lady, to admiration, no? I can brush your hair a la dow, I can plaster it a la blouse, or I can erect it a la formidable.
A la formidable? What have you said, cousin? I have never heard of that before.
Oh, la, Fanny, how ignorant you are, child. Do pray, sir, explain it to her.
The formidable is the reigning court fashion, no?
Cousin,
How well he speaks French. Well, sir, I think I shall have my hair done à la formidable.
Okay.
Throw your eyes upon this mirror, madam. Aye. Has anything ever looked so spectacular?
Well, to be sure, it is quite another thing indeed.
Well, madam, I may believe I may lay down the comb. Hmm? I took it up to oblige you, lady. See, I work in a higher sphere. Divination is my science. If you would allow me the honor, madam.
Oh, well, first, let me know the fate of my ticket in the lottery. My number is 1229. And then next, my neighbour, she's 1228.
Well, I am pleased to assure you, ladies, that it must be one of the two numbers now on the wheel.
Oh, mine! Mine! Oh, charming, yes! Oh, Fanny dear, you know it must be mine because you've never had any luck set against me.
No, I wouldn't for all the tickets in the wheel be set against you, cousin.
Sweet, amiable girl.
Mr. Conjurer, a £10,000 prize. Then I shall have a phaeton and ponies of my own and a coach and a valet de chambre to follow and all the blessings of life.
What an ecstasy of vulgar joy. My lady, your heart, you were saying, perhaps if you give me your hand again, I could tell you some news of that.
Well, if you insist, but I'm afraid you won't find that such an easy matter. Oh.
Oh, my word. Do pray me, do look here. It see the line run down the middle. It's too shallow to be a river, more of a stream, as it were, a brook, perhaps. Listen, it goes neither north or south or east, so I guess it must go west. So what does that make, Miss Westbrook?
Westbrook, cousin, only think of that!
Westbrook? Sure, well, that must be the name of your sweetheart.
Charles Westbrook was, to be sure, my sweetheart, as you call him, but he isn't my sweetheart anymore. Oh, no, no, no. Do, Mr. Conjurer, tell me the name of my new love.
No, the hand will say no more. God is ever so plain to me right now. I do believe, madam, in the zodiac of your eye, I can see a new sign. It is neither a ram or a bull or a crab, but a camel.
Camel! Camel, the name to a letter! But tell me, Mr. Conjurer, which of my two loves am I to have?
Both, or neither, madam.
Well, there, I'm quite sure you are out now. You don't think I'd be so naive as to throw my life away upon some beggarly cadet?
Oh, dear cousin, you mustn't call Mr. Westbrook that.
Well, Fanny dear, why don't you have your fortune told then?
Because I have none to tell. For I will never trust my happiness to the stars, but to my own good to my own good conduct.
Highly sententious indeed, Miss Fanny. Well, Mr. Conjurer, here is half a crown for your efforts. Buy yourself something nice, yes. Now do sum up our destiny.
As you wish, madam. you shall be as fortunate as fair. And Hyman's choicest gifts shall be reserved for her.
As fortunate as fair, Fanny, could anything be more charming?
Why? Who in the name of the old one are you then? Why, who are you, sir?
Lord, Papa, I sent him to dress my hair, and as you can see, he has done a most charming job.
Be all about your business then, friend. But I hope she paid you for your trouble.
I've been overpaid, sir.
If they put your head in an oven, Dolly, there'd be enough paste about it to make a pie, and none too savory one neither. She's safe for 1 hour farthing. Funny, I have a secret to tell you. Dolly's tickets come up. It's here in the newspaper.
And a prize?
£10,000!
Oh, Uncle! Let me fly to tell her!
Shh. Not a word upon your life. Don't you think I'm as bad as you are at least? But I mean to tell her it's a blank. To try how she'll bear the disappointment.
Oh, Uncle, I never knew you so ill-natured. Do pray let me have the pleasure of being the first to tell her.
Upon me conscience, I know the right you have to tell her first, but that you heard it last, so be quiet. Little fool, yeah. One would think you haven't any lost yourself to see you in such joy.
You cannot think, sir, that because my cousin's ticket has been more successful than mine, that I should think that I have lost something. I really think I am almost as glad as if it were my own. Dolly has had her heart set on it, you know, and I never did. Your kindness supplies me with everything I want.
You are a good girl, and I love you almost as much as my own child. But you know my duty is to my own flesh and blood. But by faith, you shall be the better of me when I die.
It may make me richer, but I'm sure your death could never make me happier.
Go along, you palaverin' hussy. Make the salt water come out of me eyes. But I wonder, you're very fond of Dolly. She is plaguey tart upon you now and then.
You know, sir, how I am obliged to her, and how good she was to me when I was a child. And until my uncle, the alderman, advised you to send her to Chelsea boarding school, nobody could be kinder. I dare say she will be the same again.
I'll say it again, you're a good girl. And you have no trifling lock of happiness stirred up in your own heart. And that's a safe place, Van, where thieves can't steal. But now I speak of thieves. As nobody stole, I would not say broke, because that'd be a burglary, Dolly, Fanny. But I'm much mistaken if Westbrook hasn't made a hole in it.
Uncle, I have no secrets that shall or might be hid from you. If Mr. Westbrook had never thought of my cousin, I certainly would have wished that he'd have thought of me.
Well, and so I shall again. Because now Dolly has forsaken him for a man she's never seen in her life. He is at liberty.
Daddy!
Here comes Dolly now. Not a word upon your life. Don't let the cat out of the bag with your foolish good nature. Let me have a little diversion with it. No, she
Daddy.
Does what she likes with me.
Daddy, good heavens, where are you?
See here, your ticket's come up.
My ticket? My prize? Dear Papa!
Blank!
Thank gracious heavens! I'm undone!
Oh, cousin! Dear uncle, let me tell her!
Quiet, little gypsy. Dolly! Don't take on so. A wise man must take all things fair and easy, like I do.
You, sir? He speaks to me who never had a ticket!
Oh, looky here! In the newspaper, number 1229.
Don't show it me! It's all over with me! Oh, what a disappointment! Who could bear it? Oh, but to think I had laboured every shilling of it in my own mind, so I had, oh!
Well then, faith, Dolly, I believe you're the better for it. All of the pleasure and none of the trouble.
Papa! How can you laugh at me? Oh, and Fanny, how can you stand there without saying a word to comfort me?
If I'm not to tell the truth, my only chance is to hold my tongue.
Come, child, give me your hand. Your tormentor shall be your comforter. Now, be a good girl, and you shall never want.
Never want, sir? What comfort is that, sir, never want? To be but a step above a beggar?
How now, Dolly? I think £5,000, and by many a hard day's labour of mine behind the counter, is not to be sneered at, eh?
Oh, Uncle, I'm sure my cousin did not mean to say that.
Fan, you're always ready with your kind word. For anyone that deserves it, I mean. But, Dolly, what would you give me if your ticket wasn't quite a point blank?
La, Papa, sir, do not tantalize me. I've lost my ticket and that's the end to it.
Then I must out with it, and wish you the joy of it at last. Dolly, the £10,000 prize is all your own.
Mine? Impossible!
Oh, lucky now she doesn't believe me.
Dear Papa, dear Fanny, can it be true?
Yes, cousin, you may believe us. I wish you joy with all my heart. I would have told you long ago, but my uncle wanted to have the pleasure for himself. And I suppose he has a right to it.
Lord, let me breathe. I can scarcely believe my senses. Well, I am the happiest creature alive. Oh, Papa, make them set the bells of ringing and I shall pay them and welcome. Oh, I wish we had the fiddles to strike up and dance.
Look at this. That's worse again. She go mad with joy. Be quiet, darling. Don't bring all the house down about yours. But I expect you'll be wanting to give me some little present or other for me, Cora.
But Fanny, dear, I must get you something too, mustn't I?
No, cousin, you need not. I rejoice with you with all my heart.
But really, cousin, I must get you something. Let me think, what shall it be? Oh, Fanny. A new hat! Yes! When I am married, which indeed won't be long before first, not indeed that I have much thought of taking up with Captain Campbell now.
Remember the captain's hint about the settlement, Dolly. It was a good broad one, too. Don't skin a threepence flint and spoil a fourpenny knife.
Well, I don't know what to say to that as yet. I don't know how matters may turn out.
Woo!
gone mad, I believe. Miss keeps such a racket with her £10,000 ticket. Well, I'm proud, however, to have it in my house. Oh, and the captain is along just now. Oh, well, stir, child, can't you? There's no lights in the sun and the fire's gone out in the comet.
Oh, bless us all!
Good, my dear fellow, where are you?
Another billet, Dolly. That captain of yours is a great scorer. They can't want to. It's secretary in his car.
Oh, come, sir. Won't you let me read it?
I'll read it myself, would you leave? Captain Campbell's respects wait upon Miss Coco. He cannot find words to express his joy at finding himself in the same house with Miss Coco. He is but this moment arrived, travelled all last night, and though he is much fatigued, yet he cannot forbear begging the favour of an audience before he goes to rest tonight. If it were only for a few minutes, it would refresh and restore him effectually.
Oh, Papa, you read it with such a provincial accent, it quite destroys the effect of the sentiment. The manner is more than half. Indeed, it is all as the elegant Chesterfield teaches.
Take it then, I don't understand the lingo. But what's this? Captain Campbell's proposal to Cornelius Coco, Esquire.
There, Fanny, you may read that. Pray, Papa, let's have them.
Oi, then comes a handsome townhouse in Portland Place, an elegant country residence. The mansion house, modernised, the old door and the gilt crest of a pelican taken down and three windows opened in the place for a garden front. Roof patent slate in pediment pitch. And a great deal more of it that's too long to read.
Oh, pray, Papa, read it all. I'm sure I shall understand it. Oh,
there's a page and a half of here the names and denominations of his lands.
A page and a half! Oh, charming!
Dolly, show me. Ha! It's too long to read. And it seems more to me like an advertisement for an estate to let.
Well, and so it is! And I intend to become tenant for life.
Be as that may, my dear, but so as you don't pay too dear, I shall be satisfied.
Well, sir, had not we better think of sending the captain an answer?
Well, that's your business, me girl. Sit down and pen an answer to your own liking.
You don't think I'd be so foolish as to favour the captain with a written response so soon? I never forget my etiquette.
That's all Hebrew to me. Sit down and write without further palaver.
But it would be odious to write on anything but gilt and hideous to seal with a wafer. Mrs. Betty! Yes, child, go down and fetch the gentleman who arrived in the chaise and four.
Captain Campbell, ma'am.
Yes, child. Give him Miss Coco's compliments. What does this girl think her aunt? And desire he'll be so good as to walk to the assembly.
Why, what's come over the girl? Be easy, can't you?
Child, what is it?
Here you are, sir, ladies. I found old
dear Mr. Thunder's gouty chair for him, don't you, handsome?
Mercy on us, cousin! He's scarcely human!
In truth, he is a little disfigured.
Madam, you see before you the very fortunate man whom you have permitted to entertain hopes of becoming pleasing in your bright eyes.
For heaven's sake, Papa, say something, for I'm thunderstruck.
Captain Campbell, my daughter Dolly. Dolly? Captain Campbell. I'm satisfied.
Nothing shall be wanting on my part, sir, and I hope the charming young lady does not retract the condescending encouragement she has given me.
For God's sake, cousin, nothing to say?
Well, sir, I must say I think I am at liberty to retract. And I must observe it was not so open of you to only prepare me for a trifling accident. For example, the loss of one limb. When surely you were to predict the shock my nerves were to receive.
I beg your pardon, Miss Coco. A fault occasioned by my too great anxiety to please. See, from the very first moments I had the most distant hopes, my whole mind has been intent upon procuring everything which I thought may please you. The most elegant coach which could be procured awaits your command.
You don't think, sir, that I would expose myself continually tete-a-tete with my husband?
Captain, my daughter Dolly has just become mistress of 10,000 pounds of her own. And upon my conscience, she begins to hold her head very high.
I'm sorry, madam, that the idea of favouring me in your company in an equipage, which I had fondly thought would be agreeable to you, would have such a contrary effect. However, I shall write this very night to Hackett to beseech the most handsomest coach he can make.
To be sure, Captain, that is very obliging indeed. But I must add, if ever I were to have the misfortune of becoming attached, yes, I should be in constant agony of distress for you in company.
Oi, in company, Dolly.
I should be adamant that every eye in the room were intent upon that unfortunate defect in one of your principal features, which I scarcely know how to mention without offending, and which I have but just brought myself to look upon now.
Madam, I am so long used to having my personal misfortunes adverted to that I have lost all susceptibility upon the subject. And in regards to the trials your sensibilities would be exposed to on my account in the high sphere of fashionable life in which I intend you perceive to move, I apprehend you will seldom permit the presence of a husband to incommode you.
Well, there you are mistaken. Indeed, Captain, from what I've heard, it's becoming quite the fashion to become domesticated, and I admit I should like to lead the charge in it vastly. It's so feminine and sentimental.
Domesticated? But with him, cousin. Sentimental.
Madam, I am overjoyed. Which encourages me to mention another slight misfortune of mine. If I could lend the captain's ear for one moment.
Dear cousin, what will come next?
Boy and Boyle, there'll be nothing left of him but a bust. It's a good thing you did not offer him your hand, because he could not have taken it.
Oh, horrid.
The captain has lost an arm. Well, if you'll excuse me, I need a few moments to recover my spirits.
Madam, for heaven's sake!
Pray, sir, spare me. Can't you see I'm ready to faint? Fanny, lend me your arm. Oh, the wretch, no arm. Oh!
Well, that's right arm of yours. Fair knocked her up. Barring that, we could have gone very well.
Sorry, Zay. Nothing which would bring my dear Coco round again. Would there nothing which would compensate?
Well, Fanny, how does Dolly find herself?
Oh, better, sir, but she still says she has a flaming ring about her heart.
Miss Fanny, you know your cousin's tastes and wishes. Could you tell me anything in which I could gratify them, anything which would please her?
Really, sir, my cousin's taste and mine are so different, and the affair is of so delicate a nature, that I hope I may be excused from interfering.
Oi, Fanny, what's any knick-knack jing and bob that'll stand in the place of an arm? I do believe I've heard Dolly speak of a phaeton and ponies, and a valet de charme.
Well, sir, is that all? Would you prevail upon her to accept of them and anything else within the compass of my fortune?
Run, Fanny, and tell your cousin.
You do not think, sir, that I would lose Miss C when such a trifle could secure her?
Oh, by Jabez, Captain, your arguments are very forcible. But here comes Dolly to answer for herself. The faith in a pony's fester, I say.
Madam, I am very overjoyed.
Well, Captain, I must say, really, it would be the height of injustice in me to be so insensible to your generosity. A phaeton and ponies, did not you say? Yes?
Don't forget the valet de charme.
And, Captain, I beg to have a paper with you which I could give, which would prevent any doubts, as I'm sure, as I am willing to perform all of my promises to Miss Coco's satisfaction. Now, I shall not intrude any more upon your time, so if the captain could assist me.
Upon me heart, Captain, but I'll call more hands. Miss Betty! Miss Betty!
Coming, sir!
Miss Betty, we want your assistance to wheel the captain off.
And, Miss Coco, I am feeling horrible and deeply unworthy when I consider my many infirmities.
Oh, don't think of it, Captain. Believe me, they'll never give me a moment's concern.
Ladies, I bid you a good night. And, Captain Coco, I'm ashamed for the trouble I have given you. I have sent my man express to town to fetch a pair of cork legs, and I hope to be a fox tomorrow.
Lackadaisy is a strange thing.
Oh, cousin, whatever will you do with that helpless being? Indeed, if I might advise you...
I thank you, Fanny. I want no advice but my own. When your turn comes, I shan't interfere.
Oh, Papa.
So what was that note he gave you on the way out, which he said was to satisfy all my wishes?
Oh, Jabez, here it is. I do hereby certify that the bearer hereof has £50,000 stock in the 3%. Signed, Alderman George Guzzle.
£50,000? Oh, Papa, I was sure he was a gentleman.
Aye, and so he is. As much as £50,000 can make one.
Now I may be done with disguises. Westbrook is himself again. Now will I reveal myself to my sweet, sweet Fanny. Mine. Adieu to Miss Coco and her £10,000 ticket. Lucky and happy may I think myself to have escaped such a compound of affectation and meanness.
No, I've scarcely recovered the use of me limbs yet. My legs are so cramped I can hardly stand. Mrs. Thunder, I have everything I want. It was not here the bell rang.
Oh,
the deuce take her!
Well then, sir, I wish you a good night and that you may rest well. And what time did you wish to be called in the morning? Oh, I suppose you left word with Betty. Good night, sir. Good night, sir. Good night.
My Jabez. Oh, she is, by the gods almighty, she is for.
Oh, it's as bad as you wanted it, sir. Shall I just get your servant to. Oh, mercy on us, what do I see before me? Oh, Christ, Jesse, what next?
Ha 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 ha! Ha! Good, Mrs. Thunder! Do keep a secret and don't betray me! I'm sure, Mrs. Thunder, you can keep a secret and you shall not be the worst for it.
Oh! Oh, well. Well, sir, for that matter, mum's the word, eh?
Well, then I will tell you, Mrs. Thunder. You know that I am Captain Campbell, and perhaps you may know that one of the ladies here is to be Mrs. Campbell.
Oh, well, sir, I had heard something of that. And which of it is it to be, if I may be so bold, sir? The £10,000 prize, is it?
You have a good guess, Mrs. Landlady.
Oh, Lord, sir, you flatter me.
But I was at a whim, Mrs. Thunder, to try the young lady's constancy before we got married, and so presented myself the cripple you saw. But Miss Coco has satisfied me, and now, Mrs. Thunder, I do hope you will not deprive me of the pleasure and satisfaction and surprise of presenting myself to the young lady in my own person.
Oh, Lord forbid, sir. I'm dumb. Do you wish to dress now, sir?
Yes, yes, if you please, ma'am.
Well, one moment, could I help you? Mercy on us! What do I see here? The conjurer's coat, sure as I'm a sinner. What a discovery. Murder will out! What do you call this then, sir? Hmm? What do you have to say for yourself? Mr. Conjurer, what tricks have you for it now?
Hmm? Mrs. Landley, do not undo me. Pray do not tell the ladies that you shall hear all. Indeed, I'll make it worth your while.
No? Oh!
No, Mrs. Landley, please.
Loose my gown, if you please, sir. Ow. Oh, I shall not be taken on by your turntables again. I shall go up to them this minute.
No, Mrs. Thunder! Mrs. Thunder!
Betty! Betty!
Please!
Necromancer and the old gentleman himself, I believe.
What does the woman mean? What alarm is here?
Oh, what's to be done about it? That's all. Pretty doings here, pretty doings. And who's to pay for his job and for and his supper? And the best room in my house. Oh, I shall not be having with it. Oh, he thought to turn the tables on me, he did. Yes, indeed, sir.
For heaven's sake, Mrs. Thunder, I am in the most violent commotion. Do stop and give us an explanation.
Your Captain Campbell there is neither more nor less than the strolling fortune teller who was prowling about the house all this day.
The fortune teller? He, Captain Campbell? Who dares to say so?
Surely, Uncle, that is very wrong.
Thank you, Mrs. Landlady.
There I saw him, sir, in his room just now, letting down his legs like some lame beggar at a fair, with the conjurer's coat staring out of his portmanteau. Oh, he thought to turn the tables on me, but I was too clever for him. He could have said he was Captain Campbell, or some entitled gentleman, or I don't know what!
Harkee! Why, Jabez! Now I think of it, I am a justice of the peace.
Oh, sir! What's to be done then?
We must proceed regularly. Send a verbal summons to the corporate.
Aye, sir. Betty! Betty! Betty, child!
Huh?
Do step into the sun this moment, child, and send for the captain this minute.
Mom!
Well, don't stand there staring like a stuck pig. Go on, get along into the sun. Bring the captain.
What an escape I'd have liked to have been finally taken indeed. Do you see what it is to have a £10,000 fortune? Hi-ho!
What is that without? Ma'am, it's your prize ticket. Your prize ticket's as sure as I'm
my ticket! Out. Give it me!
Here it is for you, Dolly. Take it as a sovereign talisman against all misfortunes past and to come.
Ma'am. Hope you won't forget poor blue coat boy.
Oh, no such thing. You did not bring the first news, my boy. We had the intelligence long before your arrival.
Yes, well, seeing as how I was sent to Bath and you'd left it, and so...
Poor little fellow.
No, my boy, see here, it's printed in the newspaper, clear as day. Number 1229, a £10,000 prize.
And if it please you, ma'am, to look at my ticket.
And I suppose it's wrong printed in the newspaper. This is number 1228.
Mine!
And it's not the 10, but the £20,000 prize.
What's that you say, fellow?
Throw a cup of cold water in her face, but make sure it's not boiling. Funny. Joy upon it with all my heart. For behind Dolly, there's not a girl in the world I wish better.
Oh, cousin, what's the matter? You still have your £10,000 prize. You'll be just the same as you were. You see, mine's a £20,000 prize, and we shall split it evenly between us, if you please.
By my conscience, you're another girl.
My lord, an escape!
Oh, faith and joy, that's not right of me at all. This girl, let me forget prisoner and justice and court and all.
Oh, sir, he said he did not care a fig for your worship. Begging your worship's pardon. But tell him, says he, he's out of his country and he has no more power than I have. God forgive him.
Upon my conscience, he's right. I'm out of my latitude, sure enough. It never struck me once before. But this fellow shall not escape.
But, sir, though he may seem to be gone, since you are a volunteer, then you may take him up.
So I shall. Mrs. Landlady, a horse, my commission for a horse.
Aye, sir. Boots, saddle smaller for his worship at once.
Uncle, if you can do, let him off for my sake.
Let him off,
For your sake, you charming, generous girl.
Oh, Charles. Oh, Mr. Westbrook.
Why, Charles Westbrook. Where do you come from?
Then I am undone indeed. Oh, Captain Westbrook.
He will turn out to be someone else in a minute.
Well, thank heavens I haven't another escape to answer for.
Charles Westbrook. So good to see you, upon my conscience. And I'm glad that you come home with your hands clean and competency well earned. With £4,000 or £5,000 in your pocket and the crimes of Nabob, then £450,000 brought together, God knows how. But that's my way of thinking of it anyway. I can't speak for Dolly there. Leave it be, I say. But now we speak of fortunes, Charles. How is it you came by that certificate of Mr. Alderman George Guzzle? Saying that the bearer had the right to 50,000.
I hope, sir, you do not think me capable of a forgery. Alderman Guzzle's certificate is true. The bearer is possessed of 50,000 pounds. And if it may please your lordship, after having seen countless men lose their limbs in the service of their country and got nothing by it, I decided to turn my talents to better account in the services of my general. And after having the good fortune of coming by the address with the assistance of a young lady of my acquaintance, I soon became one of his choice favorites. Suffice it to say, we became such good friends so soon, he offered me a contract to supply our army with legs and arms. Oi, cork for the officers and wood for the common soldiers. It's inconceivable the profits I made from the war in the last 3 years. But to make sure I went the right way about it.
Wait, Charles, I'm glad on it. And I'm gladder still that you haven't blackened your fingers with a forgery, even in jest.
Aye, indeed, sir. And by what name may we wish you joy?
Captain Westbrook, surely this cannot be the small fortune you wrote of me this morning that you thought would not cover me. How could you think me so unreasonable? No, and now I see, if you'll forgive the frolic's sake, for I had a mind to try you as you did me. But now I'm convinced there has been absolutely nothing between us this whole time but the difference of a name. And so I accept Captain Westbrook instead of Captain Campbell, and I shall please both of my loves. Ha 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 ha.
Madam, you do me honor, but you must not forget the secrets that you told your fortune teller this morning. Put your sentiments of Charles Westbrook beyond all doubts.
Oh.
And if I retain any doubts at all of Miss Fanny's, then I hope you will extract them from me.
You know my heart, Uncle, and I hope approve of my choice.
Upon my conscience, I'm glad that both of you come together, because the both of you deserve each other.
La, Miss Fanny, I wish you joy with all my heart. I know who I wish for all day.
Thank you, my good girl.
Well, Miss Coco, I am sure one of my predictions has been accomplished. I did find you as fortunate as fair, so I hope, madam, you enjoy your prize.
Indeed, Captain, there you are wrong again. The prize is not mine, but has gone to a more fortunate, more deserving object.
Funny. Well, I am glad, but I had not known of this before I might have been suspected.
No, Mr. Westbrook, you are secure from such a suspicion.
Fair and softly there, Charles. If you're thinking to share a £20,000 prize with my niece, the little simpleton has given half of it to one who won't be giving it back again.
There she went.
In a hurry.
Funny, that is so like you! Because your good fortune has given me some and no small pleasure. And if I know my heart the way that I do, generosity has given it more.
Ah, well then, sir, madam. Birds! Don't send Raven and Smiler out to grass this morning, for I'm sure his lord and ladyship will choose a four in the morning.
No, Mrs. Landlady. We shall spend a merry day at the Piggin Castle tomorrow to make amends for all the trouble I have given.
Oh, God bless your worship.
And Mrs. Betty, if I may recommend my little blue coat boy for your protection. We won't forget you, my little boy.
With pleasure, madam. I've taken quite a fancy to the little master. I'll do my best to take care of him. If only for your ladyship's sake, God bless you.
Now come, Dolly. Don't be sad. With £10,000 in your pocket, you can't long want your match.
His appeal. He finds that his olio has suited your taste with its harmless ingredients, though hashed up in haste. But less critical quacks, like the ghosts of Apicius, should any poisons lurk in each dainty delicious. Should we see in our justice a satire on laws, or what's 10 times worse, on the volunteer cause? But you'll surely forgive him of any transgression. For what single man represents a profession? When Shakespeare pictures of horror affrights us, or with scenes of rich humor informs and delights us, whoever supposed Richard a libel on princes? Or when perils is detected, what soldier ever winces? Or when Congreve in story displays Lady Pliant as the type of their sex, should my ladies cry fire on it? Or my lord's hiss at Ben as a stain on his glory? Whilst our navy boasts leaders unrivaled in story.
We'd love to say a really big thank you to Christine and to Donna up back for answering all our questions and giving us the opportunity to put on this play. We really, really enjoyed it, and thank you so much.